just going to go ahead and point it out because I think it's really important. The very last note, it's got to sound resolved. Same thing. And so I think we're just a little bit too short with it. Could I hear the last couple measures? Beautiful. Yeah, that's great. And I'm not sure that it's necessary to have vibrato on the last note, especially as we do that in the K. You can, but I think it's a straight tone. It's absolutely appropriate there. Now, sometimes with my students, I'll make a playful comment to them, and I'll say, you're making my job too easy. And what I mean by that is you're not challenging me to say something. Now, you're a good player, but there's something like right away. What am I going to talk about? What do you guys think? What are we not really doing? Dynamics, of course not. It's do you play with dynamics? Yes. But our range is really so narrow. And this music demands it. I mean, I guess all music does, of course. But we gotta play the phrases here. We gotta play it much stronger. We need softer softs, louder louds, everything in between. So rather than trying to practice in the context of the music, we're gonna take it outside of the music. What key are we in? We're in G minor, so two flats, right? So I know in Texas we know our major scales really well, not always our minor scales. I want to hear G natural minor scale, and I'll play with you. And one cool thing about this etude is almost always when it's ascending, it does what? It's marking your part to crescendo. And it's when descending, it decrescendos. It's the opposite. So I want to hear you play. Let's play together. We're going to go up from middle G up to your high D, which is like where you top out mostly here, then back down to G. And we're going to start pianissimo up to, let's go to fortissimo, and then back down to pianissimo. Maybe do it in half note. Ready? But that'll work. I'll tell you what. Can you play your natural minor going up? I felt like you got too loud too quickly, and so I sensed that you're going to run out of room here. So here's your G natural minor scale. All the same notes as B flat major. Can we try again? Reserve the crescendo so that it's absolutely even. Now, one thing that you're not really playing with, and I want to hear more, is vibrato. And you may as well practice both because vibrato is such a critical part of playing this. Try again. You're doing great. Two. Ready? Is that pianissimo? No, that's what? Yeah, maybe. You know, it's a little softer. More air. I think 90% air, 10% time. So you're playing E natural and F sharp on the way up. So if you're going to do that, fine. I want you to play F natural and E flat on the way down. But what's important here is this. That was exceptional. And I like the vibrato, too. Now we have like a dynamic range here. Without talking more about it, can you play from the beginning? Expand your dynamics. Make me tell you, it's just too musical. You have too many dynamics. Make me say that. Thank you. interesting. Better?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I like it too. I mean, everything about it's better. Now, let me ask you this. Did he just get better? Is he better now? Well, it sounds better, but I don't think he's actually a better player. I just think we committed to doing something you can already do. You did not get better in the last, like, 30 seconds. It was just that you committed to something you can do. And I think that's a big part of doing this at a high level. Progress is about making, like, short things. It's like short progresses, like doing the little things. But mostly it's about committing to the stuff you already know how to do. You have this information. You know you got to put more dynamics. So our process here is we took it outside of the music. You know, we did it in something else. We applied it to a scale, and now it's easier to kind of reapply it back into the music, which is excellent. We got to talk about how we start notes, because I'm hearing this as a recurring issue, and I'm always hearing... So what's causing that? Why are we not getting that pitch? What do you think?
It may talk us too loud.
Yeah, well, could be. It could be. But same thing, someone said it was a voicing thing earlier. That is a consideration, but I don't think it's that. I think it's more basic than that. What do you think? I think it's tightness, and I think it's that, but I actually think in this case it's a little more has to do with slow airstream. The airstream is moving too slowly. It's a combination between the two. When we think about the saxophone embouchure, we really need a degree of plushness here. Is that tightness? I'm not doing anything with the tom. Like, I'm not like voicing it up. That is absolutely just like me clamping down on the reed. So I have an idea. We're going to start, it's the lower you go, the more challenging it becomes because you got to push more air through the instrument. So let's practice it in the short tube. Can you start with a C natural? Got to hear. Yeah, it's good. So extraneous noise. One thing I noticed from you is when you breathe, you always breathe a little bit through the instrument. So I hear. And for those of you who have a saxophone right now, can you breathe in through your instrument like that? Taking a full breath through the instrument. How does it feel? Yeah, it actually like hurts me a little bit when I do it. Like that's how much tension I feel. And so, yeah, we always have the embouchure set, but you gotta make sure you're practicing through the corners. Think a lower breath. I like po breath. Can you guys say po?
Po.
Now say it like this. Yeah, now make it more silent. When you hear, that's tension in the throat. Can you make it? Yeah, when you do it really well, like I feel it pinch just a little bit here. And it makes it so much easier to support because you engage the abdominal wall. Can I hear a pull breath? Yeah, now pull breath and start on C. Good, on B natural. Do you hear the noise in the breath? Let's make it more silent. I'll take it, clear. I think your reed is a little too soft. I'm hearing that just a little bit. Reed selection matters so much because we depend on a reed to make a good sound. And that's why you need to plan a great Van Doren reed. And there just happens to be a selection here. I mean, that one seems a little soft, a little buzzy, so I'll watch that. Here's B flat, continue. See, okay, so that's different than the stuff before. So we need to evaluate, what are we doing differently? I think it's grip, it's too much grip here. Think about relegating the pressure of the corners and plush here. Oh, silent breath. Okay, I'll take it. Continue. A. All right. Okay, A flat. Set your fingers before you play, and we got a. This is what I hear. Here's what I want to hear. Separate the teeth. Yeah, and here's your G. Almost. So what I hear is your airstream is too diffuse, and we got to focus it into a point. So get your air into a single point out here. Direct the air outward. Yeah. You know, what you might start is doing some exercises where you start con niente, like this. You play, like I see your corners out like a lot, so I see this sort of tightness. And I think the key for you is going to be to get this in right here. And look, So those are the big things, because he's really a great player. The tempo was fine. I have a similar comment that if I were doing it, I'd play just a little bit faster. It's Andante, it's easy to get stagnant, but the tempo you're playing is still appropriate, certainly within the range. It's about playing with dynamics here. It's about the phrasing stuff. The other part of it is I noticed that when we're coming off of rest, we have trouble starting notes. And the reason why is it has to do with the airstream not having the focus that we need, but also the tightness in the embouchure. And the key that you want to think long-term with this embouchure is in. Go to the corners in and really great the pressure in. Here's the thing, and this is my last part of it. Reeds don't work like strings. When you pluck a string, it vibrates freely in the air. The reeds have to vibrate against something. And so on, like the saxophone, for instance, the reed vibrates against the mouthpiece, against the table and the rails. We have to make sure that we're giving it enough support against the rails. So like this part of it, this corner part in, I think it's really important that we get enough support right there. But it just so happens to help keep a degree of plushness in the lip. And that's a primary difference that I find with embouchure between when I'm playing clarinet and when I'm playing saxophone. Is with clarinet, you know, the saxophone is naturally brassy, acidic a little bit. Whereas the clarinet in the low register especially, it's responsive, actually. It responds really well. And so that tightness here with the flat chin, that works really well for that instrument in a way that it actually doesn't quite on the saxophone. We want natural looking chins, but without exaggerating the flatness, because it makes the lip a little too tight. You gotta have a little, it has to be firm, yet plush, like a really firm pillow. And then to me, like the key is just supporting that. You're doing a great job. Congratulations to you.